By Nicolas Templier from Cornell, who will be speaking about large values of automorphic forms and integrable systems.
Thank you. And first, I would like to thank very much the organizers for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to talk here. So in this talk, the main question will be as follows. Automorphic forms live on moduli spaces, and very often these spaces are non-compact. So the question is, what happens, what can one say towards infinity? So we know, for instance, Eisenstein series have moderate growth, cusp forms have rapid decays, but can we say more? Can we say something more precise? So that's the essence of the talk. So first, let me give you some kind of quick overview in just one board of what I think is going on. So I'll draw my space like this. Imagine some cusps. And the first thing I want to mention is that towards infinity, there is something interesting, which I will call quantum toda. So one of the goals of the talk is to explain this. So it's an object which is very known to physicists, quantum toda. And it was kind of known that this kind of occur at infinity. But from my viewpoint, it hasn't been really exploited yet. And so one way to exploit it is that I will explain that there is a transition when we go from the bulk of the space to the boundary, where very interesting things happen. And here you see the airy function. You see, that's a new feature, the PRC function. And I will explain that a framework to understand these things is in terms of Lagrangian mappings. Okay, so first let me start from a very general, that's kind of general framework. And in this generality, in fact, there is a result by Ermander, which I will recall first, that if B is a bounded set in any Riemannian manifold, and you have a Laplace eigenfunction on it, I will always normalize it to be L2. Then Ermander proved, in fact, in even greater generality, but that's enough general for my purpose here, that the supremum on B of F is less than the eigenvalue to the dimension minus 1 over 4. Okay. The main example I will be interested in is locally symmetric spaces, which I will write in this way. S will be my globally symmetric space, so S is G mod K, where G is a reductive group, and K is a maximal compact. Familiar example is upper half plane. H is SL2 mod SO2. Or you can think SL and R mod SON. And gamma is a lattice in G. which means this is discrete and this quotient has finite volume. And I want to be non-compact, so this means gamma is non-uniform. Okay, so in this context, the F have a name, they're called Ricker mass forms. Right, so I will assume this. And the Ricker operators will play a little bit of role, but not so much in this talk. So I will write TPF is alpha, say FP, F. So it's the same object, the Laplace eigenfunction, it just have a different name, but it's the same kind of functions. Okay, and here, in this generality, there is a very important theorem, and this is the first question one should ask is, does such an F actually exist? And it's delicate. In fact, it follows from the Weyl's law, which holds if gamma is arithmetic. So here, it's, in this generality, it's a great result by Lindenstrauss and Venkatesh. They have a, in 07, so they have a brilliant shortcut that works in complete generality and establish the existence of this F. So what they show is a number, this is a Weyl's law, number of all such F, eigenvalue less than some T square, is asymptotic to a constant, which is essentially the volume, T to the dimension, as T goes to infinity. Okay, in this talk, I will be mostly interested in SLN. And for SLN, we know a little bit more. So let me briefly mention that we know the Weyl's law with remainder term, and that's thanks to lots of work by many people on the trace formula. So if gamma is inside SLN Z, then so we know more. I will not mention all the names, but in fact, it starts for SL2Z by Zellberg in 56 when he invented the trace formula. Then there is work by Steve D. Miller for SL3, Werner Müller for SLN, Lapid Müller got a remainder term, and recently, Jasmine Matz with myself. We have the SLN Z case, and for instance, one thing we can prove is that for any prime P, for any theta positive, there is a constant rho, so such that the Weyl's law is true, but even more, the number of F lambda less than T square, which have a non-tempered Ricker eigenvalue, so log p alpha f p greater than theta. So it's not expected, and we show it's small. So it's less than t to the dimension minus rho. So for SLNZ, we know that exceptions to Wamanujan are sparse. Because the number of such F is much less than the total number given by Weyl's law. Okay. So the main result I want to talk about is the following. So again, let gamma be congruent subgroup of SLNZ. And let me give a name to an explicit constant I will call Cn. It's kind of easy to remember. It's n times n minus 1 times n minus 2. You divide by 24. Okay, and the main theorem I want to mention is that John work with Plenary. We investigate what happens for the values of f near infinity. So we are going to take the subnorm again. So for any f as above, which we know exists. So let me add some technical things that we assume that it's regular and tempered at infinity, which is also a mild condition. Most forms are regular and tempered. So we have that the supremum for G in gamma mod SLN R mod SON of FG. So is at least lambda to the Cn, and let me have an epsilon of room. Okay, so why does it tell me something interesting about the form? So maybe you already noticed something, that the Cn is cubic in n, whereas the Ermander bound is the dimension. And what's the dimension of SLN R mod SON? Well, it's quadratic in n. Like it's nn plus 1 over 2 minus 1. So it almost contradicts the other upper bound. So let me write that if n greater than 6, then this lower bound is bigger than the upper bound. So why is it not a contradiction? Because, do you see the difference why it's not a contradiction? Exercise. Right, because there is a bounded set B. I was careful to put at the beginning. And here I'm taking the supremum over the whole space. Of course, so what we show is just that the supremum over the whole thing is bigger for most F, because there are some constants hidden here, so it's true for almost all f's, is bigger than the supremum over g in any ball of fg. So we can choose b to be any bounded subset. So corollary, what it means informally is that maximum of f is achieved in a cusp. It cannot be, if it's large, it has to be large in the cusp because it's bigger than on any bounded set. So it's kind of a qualitative consequence of this result. So you might wonder, why is this n greater than 6? So in fact, we believe it's true for any n. And to give you some evidence, I have to discuss n equals 2, 3, 4, 5. So let's go over these remaining cases. So if n equals 2, the modular curve is, I think, is a picture here, right? So what I'm saying is that you take a modular mass form, is it high in the cusp? And so here there are some results analogous to this. So if n equals 2, so what we know is that sup g in gamma mod h, f of g, is at least lambda. So I will put my constant C2. But I will add something which I will call beta 2, then minus epsilon. So this constant C2 is 0, as you can see. So there is a beta 2 here, which is, in fact, 1/6. So I'm saying the lower bound here is 1/12. So what's this mysterious beta 2? So I will explain later in the lecture, but let me say that this 1/6, which is beta 2, is a singularity index of the Airy function, or the singularity of the Airy function. So let me say of K Bessel and Airy. So that's the lower bound, which was noticed several years ago. So to say more, we need to discuss upper bounds. And upper bounds, we need to beat 1/12, which is extremely difficult. So in fact, for n equals 2, this corollary is not known. But there is a famous conjecture, the random wave conjecture, for instance. Or random, let me say random wave model, which says that in these cases, for the modular curve, the supremum G in B, FG, should be, so let me put two question marks because this is very much out of reach, to a lambda epsilon. And if these were true, then yes, maximum is in the cusp. Okay, so if n is 3, we know also something similar. So this function is at least lambda to the C3 plus beta 3 minus epsilon. And beta 3 now is 1/4. And what's 1/4? It's the singularity index of another function, the Peercy function, which is a higher singularity. Singularity index of Peercy function. So I will explain this right now. And before that, to be complete, I can say something in case n equals 5, too. So if n is 5, situation is that the upper bound can be improved, and that's just enough to get me the corollary. So let me explain that, in fact, this corollary, we know it unconditionally if n is at least 5. And for 5, you have to struggle quite a bit. In fact, it's the work of several people. So Ivanesh Sarnak Venkatesh, Rikota, Roye, Holovinsky, Blomer and Paul, Blomer, Maga, and Marshall. So what they prove is that they improved the Ermander bound in this context. And what they show is that in this bounded set, the supremum Fg is not just less than lambda to dimension minus 1 over 4, but in fact dimension minus rank over 4 minus delta. Okay, and that's just enough to to get me the n equals 5 case. Okay, so now I'm going to explain in more details what's going on exactly in the cusp. And so I mentioned these special functions. You see some K Bessel, Airy, Percy. What's exactly the content here? And in fact, it was very much inspired by physics. At least I've read quite a bit of literature on quantum TODA. So what I'm going to do is I will try to summarize in a nutshell what's known in this literature that's relevant to this question. So I will start with a one-dimensional Bessel function. And here I will focus on the K Bessel. So Bessel K nu y. So y is the argument. It's a positive real for me here. And nu is any complex number. OK, so one way to define it is that it satisfies the Bessel differential equation, which looks like this, y square d2 dy square plus y d over dy minus y square plus nu square. So the function is annihilated by this operator. So you recognize something which looks like a Schrödinger operator. And so in fact, there is a system attached to this. It's kind of an oscillator, and let me draw it. You think of two particles which attract each other, and the distance is a little bit strange, but it's log y. So y is positive, so I can take the log. The log is positive or negative, which means maybe this particle is on the right or on the left. There is a potential energy. The potential is y square. Okay, and, then I'm claiming this is a Schrödinger equation for some energy, and the energy is nothing else but minus nu square. So energy is minus nu square. Okay, so for SL2, that's what you see. A special function, and what happens for other groups? So for other groups, what you see is something called the Whittaker function. It's very analogous. I will write it W nu nu of G. G lives in this symmetric space S, which is G mod K. Nu is a complex parameter which has several components. So in fact, it lives in AC star, but for SLN, just think as n minus 1 complex numbers. And also, since I will talk about SLN, I can put coordinates on S, and I will take the simple roots of G, which I will denote by y1 to yn minus 1. So in this case, you have one root, it's y. Okay, so formally, it satisfied two things. W nu of UG is psi u W G for all u in U, where psi is a character on U. U is a maximal unipotent of G. And U, like here, is an eigenvalue. So it's a multiple eigenvalues of several operators. So it's an invariant differential operators on S. Okay, you can take this as a definition. So maybe a shorter definition, and since this conference is number theory and physics, is to take this model. And so what's the extension to several variables? It's you make a chain. And in fact, this chain exists. It's called the TODA chain. So you make the TODA chain. So at least for SLN. It exists for other groups. For concreteness, let's focus on SLN. And what's going on is you just put n particles. So it's a chain. Distance are log yi. Log yi is the distance between two nearby particles. The potential energy is the sum of the yi square. And the energy is norm nu square, or maybe minus norm nu square. Okay, and you can write down the analog of this equation. It's the sum yi square partial square yi square plus yi. And you have some mild cross terms, which is yi plus 1 partial square yi plus 1. And then again, minus sum yi square plus nu square. Okay. So, and interestingly, the first question you should ask here and do these operators have solutions? So, are there eigenstates here? And again, it's a non-trivial question, but it's been answered quite long ago in this context by Jacquet. And his answer is that he constructs something called the Jacquet integral, which is an integral representation for this function. So it's a kind of the best way to give a function is to give an integral that converge and give the function. And then to get the new in all ranges, it has to do partial integration by parts and analytically continues on the whole plane. So it's called Jacquet integral. So let me write it for you. So W nu g, you integrate over this unipotent. So you will do this in order to create this equivariance. So I want a psi u bar du. Right, so in fact, I will write it. So this psi u bar, I will write it in exponential form. So it's a unitary character. So let me write it as exponential I L, where L is a linear form. So L goes from u to c. And then I rewrite it schematically as exponential I nu h w u g minus l u du. That's essentially the integral. So l u is this linear function. H is the Iwasawa projection. So whenever you have a g, you decompose u a k. You write g is u exponential hg k. That's the h. W is a long vial element. And u is a variable of integration. And g is a variable. So Jacquet shows that this function analytically continues. Yes, question? R equal to 0? What's R?
The equation is the operator applied to the function equal to 0.
Absolutely, yes. So it's annihilated by this operator. Oh. And very soon, I will show you that there are more operators than annihilate the function. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so any other question? So far, it's kind of classical, and that's what people used long ago. But since you have this very nice model, you can ask, is there more? Can you say more? And in fact, there is more. So I will try to summarize this quickly in terms of formula. But it fits, in fact, in the general framework of what I would call Mirror symmetry. It's been mentioned this morning in Fernando's talk. So let me write Mirror symmetry. And in fact, it's kind of the modern way I think about the Jacquet integral. And in fact, it explains why there should be this nice integral here. Okay, so let me explain how to see at a concrete level this Mirror symmetry, because this kind of these are very concrete objects. So I will do something a bit strange. I will take this Bessel equation that's well known, and I will write in another form. So I will write this as determinant of y d over dy y square minus 1 minus 1 d over dy plus nu square. Okay, so it's the same operator. Okay, and since we do things in a strange way, maybe let's make it even more complicated, in a more complicated way, and let's add, this looks like a characteristic polynomial in linear algebra, so let's add an x variable. So why not take determinant y d over dy minus y d over dy y squared minus 1 and plus a diagonal matrix XX, and then I will subtract what I expect as a characteristic polynomial of X, so X minus nu, X plus nu. So if X equals 0, that's my Bessel operator. And in fact, it's equal, because the trace of this matrix is 0. And the x square cancel out. Okay, so maybe the first time you've seen the Bessel operator written in this way. But there is an advantage. The advantage is that now I can write these operators and much more in a kind of condensed form. And that's what goes in the literature under quantum toda. So that's kind of the first feature, is that you can write this determinant. Let me take n equals 3. So then I have a 3 by 3 matrix. Y1 partial y1, y2 partial y2, minus 1 y1 partial y1. Minus y2 partial y2. So that's what's on the diagonal. So this matrix is 3 diagonal, which shouldn't surprise you because interaction is between nearby neighbors. So here it's a 0. And on the off diagonal, well, it's a potential. So minus 1 y1 square, y2 square, minus 1. OK, so that's my big matrix, and I add x, I, y3. And I subtract this thing, which is a characteristic polynomial with parameter nu of x. OK, and think that these operators annihilate w nu. W nu is in the kernel of this. So in fact, it's a linear system of operators, because for each coefficient in x, I have a different operator. So this is trace 0. So one coefficient is trivial. The other coefficients, one of them give me this. And the other give more. In fact, they commute. with each other. And these kind of things are called quantum integrable systems. So it's called quantum integrable because there is a structure in the classical case. You can take this Toda chain and make it oscillate classically with time. You write down the equation. But again, there is a rich structure, which here is captured by the Lax equation. And you will see that the Lax equation is very related to this determinant. So the Lax equation is the following. You take S, a tree diagonal matrix, which I will assume to be symmetric. And the equation is S dot, derivative with time, is a bracket of another matrix which depends on S with S. So what's BS? In this case, BS is the upper part of S minus the lower part of S. Matrix of the same size, but anti-symmetric. And you take the bracket with S. OK, so what's S in this context so that we are not lost? S is nothing else but Y1, Y1, Y2, Y2, P1, P2, P3, where this Y1, Y2 are these positions, and the P's are the momentum. So it's an exercise if you want to verify that the Lax equation gives me the equation of motion. But in fact, it gives more. Much more, it gives that the system is integrable. For instance, you can show that the characteristic polynomial of S is preserved by the flow. That's also an exercise. So characteristic polynomial of S is preserved by the flow. OK, so this motivates also this kind of structure. And this captures the Whittaker function. OK, so now we have a linear system of PDE, or it's called D-module. One thing to look at is you look at its solution, you look at monodromy around points. And the fact is the Bessel equation has irregular singularity at infinity, even for dimension one. So that's a key feature. In Jeff Lagaria's talk, we saw a lot of monodromy around points. It was regular singularities. Here it's an irregular singularity at infinity, regular at zero. So it's irregular singularity at infinity. So it's also quite interesting, because if the singularity are all regular, there is a Riemann-Hilbert correspondence which classifies all the solutions. So here, kind of the structure is subtle, and that's why just the existence of the eigenfunction is kind of deep. Okay. So the next thing you look at when you have a D module is a characteristic Lagrangian. And so in this case, in fact, it is Lagrangian. And one way to view it concretely with these formulas is that here you have kind of a phase. And it's called superpotential in physics. And what you can do when you have a phase function is you do a stationary phase approximation. And what it gives you, again, is a Lagrangian inside space of parameter. So you have a Lagrangian. So I will denote it by lambda nu. where does it sit? So in fact, naturally, it sits in the cotangent bundle of S. But here there is an extra structure, which is psi equivariance in terms of U. So it's natural to do something called symplectic reduction. I will not explain the details, but it's like taking a quotient, but in the symplectic framework. So think about this as phase space. It's a phase space for my problem. And in fact, if you think it in these terms, it's kind of concrete. It's positions, momentum. So you have a phase space. Okay, and the phase space projects to the to the space. And the space is S mod U, which is given by these Ys. So in fact, S mod U is nothing else in this case than R positive. Okay, so the fact that it's phase space, it means that this is called a Lagrangian vibration. Because all the fibers are Lagrangian, and the composition, that's really what I'm interested in, is called a Lagrangian mapping. So it's been studied by Tom, Arnold, and his school. They have a book, and the one key point is that they explain is that to study the singularity of this Lagrangian mapping exactly tells me information about the function. Okay, so another thing I want to explain in this generality is how do you go from these special functions to the main theorem, which has automorphic forms. So let me give you in a nutshell what the arguments are. So it's kind of how to go from a global situation to the local situation. So remember that F was on S mod gamma on the modular curve. So what you can do is write that this supremum of F is at least supremum of some W, which is proportional to W nu. So what's W in here? In fact, what's the link between F and W? That W is integral of F along the orosphere. Okay, and this kind of picture, once you know the singularity index, you know that this is greater than lambda, which is the norm of mu square, to this constant Cn, beta n, which I will explain in a minute in examples where it comes from, times the L2 norm of W. So this kind of gives me this bound. So here it's L2 norm. Okay, and it's not done yet because I want to control this. And that's where some number theory comes in. And it comes in this form, that the L2 norm of F is equal to a value at the edge of an adjoint L function times norm W2. So this follows from Rankine-Zollberg's theory. So in analysis of automorphic forms, this formula is kind of very important. It gives you the size, the L2 normalization of forms. Even for SL2, it's used all the time. And it's valid at least for SLN. And I get a value of an L function, which is a delicate numerical quantity. And a priori, it should be conjecture that it varies mildly. And here what I know is that it's less than lambda to the epsilon, W2. Okay, and this bound is, in fact, recent, is due to Shen and Li. It's called convexity bound at the edge for this L function. It says that this L function is not too large. Okay, and if you combine this line with this, which is more number theory, you get exactly the main theorem. The inequalities go in the right way. So in fact, this scheme is interesting. You can also play with it in another way. You can, you keep Rankine-Zollberg. It's an equality, so I'm not going to change it. But when you have an equality, you can try to play one against the other. And one interesting question is lower bound for L1, which is like the prime number theorem. And here, there's an interesting paper by Sarnak and then developed by Gelbart, Lapid, Sarnak, where schematically their approach is to say that you have this kind of scheme of inequalities, but instead of getting a lower bound for F from an upper bound for L, what they do is they prove an upper bound for F, in fact, for an Eisenstein series, I have to use Mass-Zellberg relations. And then they deduce a lower bound for L1. So it's a spectral proof of the prime number theorem. It's kind of this idea in reverse. Right, so I put this on the board because I think this kind of scheme applies more generally to here. I didn't use anything very specific about groups. I mean, you can try to replace U by other periods. And it's not done yet, but I think that's the direction which is worth investigating. Because there has been lots of work. You can write this, lots of work on period formulas, and you get L functions and so on. Okay, so to finish, let me explain a little bit what beta n comes from and give an example of this, so then you get a concrete example. Okay, so this is a very well-developed subject, notably by René Thorn, Arnold, and his school, where their goal was to classify singularities. And so I will just give you the example of this and this for n equals 3. So for K Bessel, it's also extremely classical for K Bessel. That it's transitioned to Airy. It was known more than 100 years ago. For instance, it's in Watson's book. K Bessel transitioned to Airy. To give you a concrete formula, you can write KIT TY, where I want T to go to infinity and y to be around 1. So it's natural because it's a turning point of the differential equation. That's where y squared plus nu squared is 0. And so up to some constant, which I will not write, it's exponential minus y over pi y over 2, the Airy function of t 2/3 z plus some error, which is reasonable if y is around 1 and t is large. OK, and there is a z, because there is a change of variable between y and z, which is complicated, but let me just say that z is around y minus 1. It's explicit, but you have to inverse a function. And what's airy? It's this explicit function, integral from minus infinity to infinity, exponential I x cubed plus zx dx. Okay. And so in terms of this theory of Lagrangian mappings, I will draw you what lambda nu is. And lambda nu is, in fact, just a circle in this case. You almost see it here. So this very classical result is pictured by this. You have, in fact, half a circle, because y is positive. So y goes from 0 to infinity. This is lambda nu. It projects to the y-axis. That's this Lagrangian mapping. The image here is exactly norm nu, or t, if I put this here. So the image is exactly the segment between 0 and t. And here, I have a singularity. The projection is not regular. And it's a fold kind of singularity, because you fold kind of two sheets. OK, and it's the simplest of all the singularities. And the fold is exactly given by, correspond exactly by this kind of function x cubed, the function x cubed. And then, in fact, this zx is a deformation of the x cubed. So, yeah. OK. And let me give you the n equals 3 case, which is new. I mean, it's an explicit calculation, where what we found is that for SL3 Whittaker, it transitioned to airy. Transitioned to airy and also Percy. So to the Percy, we write it this way, where PC function is another kind of singularity. So I will write it, give you the formula, where instead of a cube, you have a power 4. You also have two variables, because you can deform x to the 4 in two dimensions. So it's exponential I, x to the 4, I think over 4, yes. Z1x squared over 2 plus z2x dx. So it's an explicit definition of a function. Right, so I will not write down this approximation. It will take too long, but I will draw you the picture. So the picture is that lambda nu project to S mod u, which is two, which is a plane. You have y1, y2. Let me draw it this way, y1, y2. So the first thing is that y1, the image, is inside y1 square plus y2 square less than 1. So I will assume that, okay, maybe I should put less than nu square. And for simplicity, let me say nu square is 1. I will normalize to be. OK, so the image, again, is bounded. It's inside unit circle. OK, but there is more structure, because this lambda nu, in fact, it's known to be a genus 2 surface. And here you can imagine that you complete y1 is positive. You, by symmetry, you can complete to y1 negative, y2 negative. Then you get the full disk. So if you do this, lambda nu becomes also compact. You get a compact surface, and in fact, it has genus 2. So you have a genus 2 surface that projects to the disk. So if you think about it, you try to put genus 2 surface above a disk, you see that inside something has to happen. It cannot just fold along a circle. And so in fact, inside there is another singularity, which is what gives rise to this PRC function. And let me write it down to you explicitly. You get another curve here, which is the set of y's where the fiber is singular, like here. So it's singular here, and on this tiny curve, which has a cusp here. And these things are just fold. Okay, and in fact, it's completely algebraic, because this lambda nu is given by algebraic equations, like this one, like the determinant of this matrix. In fact, that's how we found it. You could plug it into an algebraic package like Macaulay or Magma or Sage. Okay, and the equation of this cusp, let me give it to you. It's given by this complicated equation, 27y1 to the 4, y2 to the 4, minus 18y1 square, y2 square, plus 4y2 square, plus 4. So it's degree 4 in y1 and y2. And this point is 1/2. And the cusp is 1 over square root 3, 1 over square root 3. So that's exactly what's going on for this quantum toda, which is a Wittaker function, how it's transition for n equals 3. So that's a case where you have 3 particles like this. So I think it's time. So let me stop here so we have time to go to the dinner. Thank you very much.